Hey everybody, and welcome to my TNA Impact Wrestling Review for February 13th, 2014. I know it's a bit late, but I'm still getting it up. Here we are live from Manchester, England. If you haven't, by the way, checked out my Q&A from yesterday, be sure to do so, as well as my Tuesday Top 10 from earlier in the week. Just other videos. I'm doing a video every day for the entire month of February. Be sure to contribute. Any questions you have for the Q&A in the comments section below on this video or any other, or through personal message or whatever, or via Twitter. Be sure to follow me at EMUltraOfficial. Add me to your circles on Google+, subscribe, all that good stuff. Yeah. Anyway, let's get into the Impact review. Enough of that stuff. So we get started off with Dixie's regime of her, Magnus, EC3, and Rockstar Spud. Of course, EC3 bills himself as the guy who retired Kurt Angle. Magnus is the greatest and only British world champion in years, but he is glad that he's in Manchester because he doesn't have to come back here for another year. That thought that was pretty good. And you get MVP and Samoa Joe coming out together, and MVP reminding Magnus of the fact that he has to defend his title at Lockdown against Samoa Joe, but they get cut off by Gunner, who comes out and pretty much just says that, well, I've got my World Heavyweight title briefcase right here, and I'm going to give you 7 days, Magnus, and in a week, you're going to face me for the world title, and I'm going to win it, and then I'm going to face Joe at Lockdown. But Dixie, of course, says that that will not be the case because he is going to be facing Ethan Carter tonight with his briefcase on the line, which causes MVP to interrupt and say, well, if that's going to be the case, then I'll add to that by having EC3's tag team title case on the line as well. So it's case and case in a ladder match, and that's how we start things off. I like that they threw the Feast or Fired cases on the line. That's interesting and something that should maybe happen a little more than never. So I'm totally fine with this being the first match of the night. Gives two guys who, you could be your next generation of main eventers a spot early on in the show. They didn't do too bad in their match, but it ended up getting interrupted by Gunner because MVP had said if there was any interference, he will even this shit up. And, of course, that was turned out to be true because Magnus did try to interfere, in which helped EC3 win the match. But that was quickly stopped by James Storm, who evens up the odds, and the match gets restarted as a tag team winner-take-all match for both briefcases. And the match was actually pretty solid. EC3 and Magnus, they told the right kind of story by having them actually dominate. Looked like they were going to win, but they argued over, who's going to take down the briefcases. And, I think it was more about the fact that Magnus didn't want to have EC3, cashing in on that World Heavyweight title spot. And there seems to be a little bit of tension growing between EC3 and Dixie, and EC3 and Magnus. We could see an eventual, or C3PO, as MVP called him, which was hilarious. It seems to be like a little bit of cracks in the regime there already. So I wouldn't be surprised to see EC3 potentially be the guy who does turn. We'll see. He really wouldn't get over, I don't think, that amazingly well as a babyface at first. I think the reason he'll get over is just because of the fact that he's against the grain of Dixie Carter, and I think pretty much people hate her enough to the point where she will get booed out of the building. But anyway, this opening match was pretty solid, and you end up getting Gunner and Storm to win. Gunner took the whole fucking thing down with them, but they win, and now they have both briefcases, the world title and tag team titles, which makes more sense because they're an actual tag team, and I guess we'll see what happens with the world title. Wouldn't mind seeing James Storm do an eventual heel turn on Gunner. Just to go for the world title, I wouldn't mind those two guys for the belt down the line. Not saying that'd be the best world title match ever, but I'd really like to see James Storm get a run with the strap. That's really what I'm trying to say. He's getting older, so there's less and less time. Really like to see him win the title. But either way, this was a nice tag team match and a good way to kick things off. So we get Anderson backstage showing a picture of his kids and saying that this is what he's doing this for. He's doing this for his family. He's doing this for the dignity of himself. To put this entire feud to rest with Bully Ray tonight in the casket match. So the bromans come into Rockstar Spud toward the office where Dixie is, and they're just curious why the hell Storm and Gunner now have the tag team title shot. And they were really glad that Ethan had it, actually, because they were bros and everything, and so obviously Ethan wouldn't cash in right away. But MVP walks in, says things are changing, and that Dixie's power is slipping. And that they can handle things in the ring, or they're going to be, you're either going to defend your titles against these guys whenever they cash in, or you're going to get stripped of your titles altogether. And then he said, tonight you guys are going to be in a tag team match. And you're going to be facing the Wolves and a mystery partner in a 3-on-3. That's Zima, Robbie, and Jesse Goddard versus the Wolves and a mystery partner who turns out to be Samoa Joe. And they are very pissed off at MVP, and who quickly says, you will not like who you, the mystery partner is. More importantly than that, one thing that was cool that I thought about tonight's show was the whole office scene by having like the tape across the middle, kind of showing symbolic, as well as the flowers, symbolic toward the power struggle and the sharing of who has the control in TNA. And that's not, I'm not the only one to notice that, but I do want to bring that up as something that was quite relevant to tonight's show, or last night's show, actually. So that match ends up happening next. Samoa Joe and the Wolves end up beating the Bromance Zima out. Nice to see the Wolves finally debut in the ring. They certainly are a very good tag team. And this was a solid match. No surprise for the finish and everything. But I enjoyed it. Good stuff. So we get Abyss coming to the ring after this, talking about you know, the whole thing that happened with him and Eric Young last week. And what was a great, in my opinion, a great Monsters Ball match. I enjoyed that quite a bit. I think that this whole story has been not as good as it probably could have, would have, should have initially been. But, I mean, having it turn out to be Abyss be, you know, the multiple personality thing, I think that's cool because you don't see that that often. It is like the Kane storyline in that, you know, they have the mask come off and everything and he turns out, you know, whatever. But at the same time, it is also different because, you know, they do the multiple personality disorders. It's not like he had a match where if he lost, he got the mask pulled off. So it was in a different way that they went about it. So that was good. But Abyss is pissed off and says that Eric Young has no idea. He's never been through any of the shit that he has. He has the scars to prove it. Basically, we see Abyss says he doesn't need help. He's done with everyone. And he's going to find someone who understands him and fix this. I don't know where this thing's going from here. I guess I'll be interested to see more matches between the two because I honestly think that Eric Young works really well in the ring. I love Eric Young. I've always been a big fan. And I think he'll definitely continue to work well. Even with Abyss, I think that this feud could go a little further. I don't really know where they're going to go with it from here. But I guess we'll see what happens with the Joseph Park Abyss character, you know, from here on out. But it does suck to see Abyss get unmasked in a way because, you know, I like when masked characters actually stay masked characters. I mean, like we always have said, I mean, I think it goes without saying that Kane's character was ruined as soon as they unmasked it. I'm not saying he never had any good matches or any good storylines after, because he did, but nowhere near as intimidating of a presence, or the initial shock of Kane was just never there again. And even when they remasked him, it just didn't come back. And I hope they don't remask Abyss ever. I hope they stick with this and allow us to realize and understand that this guy is who he is. I think that they tried to do it. It didn't really work out well, but they're starting to tie it up in a decent way. Like, they're tying up the loose ends in a better way with this Eric Young feud, and I think that these couple guys could wrestle another match at Lockdown or whatever, and that would be completely okay with me. By the way, whatever happened to the TV title? Oh, yeah. Never to be seen again, apparently. So Velvet Sky walks in, asks to call off the match with Chris Sabin. That's scheduled for later tonight. Please do. Dixie tells her she can't, and that Velvet is getting paid to wrestle, not sit on her backside. Obviously Velvet is not very happy about that. MVP asks, like, why she would do something along these lines. And then you end up getting, basically, putting MVP in a match with Rockstar Spud by having her say, oh, I wish that you still wrestled, whatever. And he said, well, I'm not here to wrestle. I'm here to improve TNA. And then Rockstar Spud says he's washed up. And then MVP says that he's a great, any great wrestler, any experienced wrestler would know to always have their gear on them. Luckily for me, I have my gear on me. So it's you and me tonight in a match, pretty much a squash match. MVP wins convincingly over Rockstar Spud. But it's good to see MVP in the ring. Then we get a segment with Bobby Roode where he, you know, is looking for Dixie, yelling in one of his anger fits, which he plays off very, very convincingly. He finds her talking on the phone about how MVP's all, you know, up in her grill. but he demands a title shot. He wants the world title. Says Dixie's lost it. You know, you're out of your mind, you're crazy, but Dixie tells him that he, you know, didn't win his match last week when he had the number one contender shot. But he says, hey, I fucking protected Magnus, I helped Magnus retain his title, you owe me a lot. And then he ends up throwing stuff and says that, basically makes a threat that you don't want me as an enemy. Yeah. aggressiveness for Bobby Roode. I like this because this could be a potential, like, Roode seems to be, you know, with them, joining them, and then ends up eventually turning face, which would be the first time in a few years since we've seen Bobby Roode as a face. But I think that would be something different and interesting, and could. I think that's good for business. I think having Roode turn face would be something different. I love when he gets pissed off like that, because he plays it very, very well. Like, he does a great job of being convincing. That's something that Roode is very underrated for. I talked about him in my Q&A the other day, but I will say again that I am a big Bobby Roode fan. Always have been. I'd like to see him get another run with the belt, considering how good his first one was. Anyway, next we've got Velvet Sky and Chris Sabin in a match, which wasn't really much of anything until we get this big, massive woman to come out. I don't remember what they said her name was. They didn't really say it on the show, but I've heard it, but I can't remember what it is. Either way, she is a freaking mammoth. Holy fuck. Her and Lady Tapa and Awesome Kong are like fucking mammoths. This woman was huge. So she did basically the master lock to Velvet, but she was swinging her so fast that Velvet's brain was going to go zip. But anyway, so Sabin ends up pinning her, pinning Velvet after all. It's said and done. That was a very pointless match and segment over, when you look at it on the surface, but at least it debuts somebody new on the Knockouts division, which they need desperately. And not only that, where the hell was the rest of the Knockouts division tonight? Again, good question. Where the fuck was the X division champion Austin Aries also? But anyway, I digress. You know, that's some of the problems that are still, you know, evident in TNA. I mean, again, the shows have been better as of late, but that doesn't mean that all the problems are fixed. There's still work to be done. But, you know, again, I'll say this much. I think that match was completely pointless. It was stupid. But what was good about it is the fact that we get a new Knockout developed, somebody who may be paired with Chris Sabin, maybe get a mixed tag match with Sabin and Mammoth versus Velvet and, you know, whomever. Well, it would be cool if they brought back, like, Alex Shelley or something to be the tag partner. Wouldn't that be awesome? Of course, that's not happening. But anyway, Casket match was next. Actually, no, before that, we get Bully Ray calling Anderson's wife and saying that that Anderson says goodbye and everything. I think you could kind of see the inside of the phone. It did not look like he was on the phone at all. So, way to make it seem convincing. But anyway, that's just a little minor detail. Either way, I think that the segment itself had impact because, you know, you're saying to yourself, man, he's calling her his wife and, you know, like, making it even more personal and saying that his life is over and everything and kind of just putting the scare into the family. So, again, making it personal was something that made this feud, I think it's what made the feud last overall. And also, we saw another Samuel Shaw segment where, you know, he said he agrees with Christy on that. They need to keep that their relationship, you know, completely professional and professional only. And he just creepily, like, sniffs his hand after, like, shaking hers. And I'll say this much. I think the Samuel Shaw character is good, and I like that they're giving him to us slowly. They're just giving us little segments on every week's Impact just to give you a little bit of a snippet. Another thing we got tonight was the Willow, which is Jeff Hardy, obviously. But, you can freaking tell. All you gotta do is watch the vignette. But the Willow is coming. I look forward to seeing what they do with this. This is actually something that Will-O-The-Wisp, which is something that Hardy has had for a while, I've heard. But here it is full-fledged, going to be in TNA. I'm interested to see where they go with that. I really honestly am. And I think it could be something good and a reinvention for Jeff Hardy. Give us something completely new and outside the box with Hardy. We know he can do many different things, and I'm sure he can do this one well, too. So I look forward to seeing Jeff Hardy return to TNA. I'm actually kind of glad he stayed with them, just because, you know, it's like finally loyalty to one place, not just for Jeff Hardy, but, you know, somebody actually sticks with the company, which is good for the company, obviously. Anyway, we got our main event match, casket match, really, really good. I loved the finish with Anderson hitting the mic check on Bully inside the casket. I thought that was a really nice touch to it. I like that Bully tried to do the pile driver in there, too. And we saw, you know, a table spot. Anderson went right through it. Again, early on, you know, use of a chair, Anderson got bloodied and everything. But this was just a really good match. It was very well told as far as the story goes. I like that Bully Ray was wearing a soccer, football, whatever, jersey. I'm from the U.S., so, you know, obviously I'm going to call it soccer, but for them it's football, I understand. But he was wearing the opposing Liverpool jersey when they were in Manchester, so obviously that got even more heat on him. And Anderson ended up stomping it and throwing it into the casket with Bowie at the end of the match, which was another nice touch, I think, to it, to the whole dynamic. I think overall that this was actually a very enjoyable main event and a good way to close out the Anderson-Bowie-Ray feud. I know that a lot of people are opposed to the whole having casket matches that don't involve The Undertaker, but I am totally okay with it if the feud could call for it. And this one, I guess you can kind of say, is a little bit symbolic of who's burying who here, with Anderson and Bully being the two guys from Aces and Eights really that are left and relevant still. And, you know, having Anderson go over is the sensible thing. He closes it out, Babyface gets the last word, and that's that. We'll see where they go from here with these two guys individually. I hope they continue to get featured on TV, because it doesn't make any sense to make this feud feel like something that matters and is a fairly important part of your television program. Hell, at the main event at this Impact, you don't want these two guys now just fall into this abyss of nothingness. You know, I mean, give them something new to do, each of them. And I think Bully Ray's, like, you know, philosophical character is certainly interesting and has a potential down the line to add more of an edge to the Bully Ray gimmick as a whole. I look forward to seeing what they do with these two guys. I mean, Ken Anderson doesn't have a ton left, I don't think, but either way, I think that right now he's getting over pretty solidly with fans. This feud with Bully Ray was decent. And he's put on a couple of nice matches with him. So I think Anderson still has more things that he can do in the company. Good match, though, overall. And then we get the final segment involving Dixie and MVP, where the match for Lockdown is officially set, where it's going to be the Lethal Lockdown of Team MVP versus Team Dixie. The winning team gets full control of TNA. Basically, MVP, she gives him an offer saying, here's a huge amount of money. Take this money and I'll take your shares, and you have no, you know, you're not no longer investing with this company at all. Completely, you're gone. And MVP says, no, I'm here to improve TNA wrestling. You should stay running the business and I should handle the wrestling. And then we pretty much get the match set up, and the passing back and forth of the flowers at the end is a power symbol. Which I liked. It was a good touch. It was something that's added. It's a little thing. It's not a big deal, but it still is a nice little touch that, to me, added to the overall depth of where they're trying to go with this main angle. Not like we haven't seen this angle multiple times, and not only in TNA, but WWE. We've seen it all over wrestling a lot with the power struggle thing. And it technically doesn't make a whole ton of sense, given the fact that, you know, MVP's just an investor. I don't know how he could have enough power to be actually, like, combating with Dixie Carter. It doesn't make as much sense on the surface, but then when you take it all into consideration, you say to yourself, remember, this is a wrestling angle. I mean, they're trying to make it realistic, but, you know, it doesn't have to be 100% factual. I think maybe we're a little bit too hard on that sometimes, myself included. But anyway, I thought that this was an all right Impact, not too bad. There were some moments that were quite good. I thought that the Feast or Fire thing to kick it off was nice. I did like that Gunner and Storm went over, of course. I like that they set up the six-man tag. It made some sense, and seeing the American Wolves debut in the ring. And what else was I going to say? Yeah, I liked seeing the casket match. That was really nice. And, of course, the setup for the Lockdown main event that we are getting at the end of this show. Other than that, that's pretty much, you know, I mean, the Velvet Sky Chris Sabin match was really pointless, but I mean, we do get a new knockout, you know, added to the situation, so that is something new as far as that goes. I mean, at least there is something to go off of there. MVP and Rockstar Spud pretty pointless, but it does give MVP an in-ring debut, so I guess everything had its reason. There were some things that were just, you know, like those couple of matches were just kind of like roll your eyes, not really so great. I think ending the show, though, with that backstage talk between Dixie and MVP was actually different and enjoyable. I wouldn't have minded it seeing end on the casket match either, because it was a really nice main event and was a great touch to the show overall. But again, you know, I will always critique. No X Division champion featured at all. No Knockouts champion featured at all. You know, I mean, that's important. If these guys are your champions and you want to make them feel as believable as they maybe should, then, you know, they should be involved in the show a little more than not at all. That's a problem that I'm always going to bring up for WWE and for TNA. If a champion isn't featured on a show like that, why do we care about them being champion if they can't even be featured on the show? That's just my question. A couple of things were just really kind of eye-rolling. And again, like I said, even though this big angle is something new, you know, compared to what we were getting before. It is something we've seen before in, on the grand scheme of things, but I think that the lethal lockdown idea is really nice and adds to the lockdown pay-per-view, as well as the fact that we're finally seeing Samoa Joe main event once again. So that's something to look forward to as well. There's good things coming. I think TNA is improving slowly but surely. Week to week, things are getting better, and their UK tour is certainly supplementing that by the great crowd that they had in Manchester this week. So, well, a few weeks ago, actually. But, you know, the tape of this week was good. So overall, I'd probably throw this show like a B-, C-plus. No, something like that. Like a B minus is fine. You know, something like that. It's hard to grade sometimes because, like, I don't really have an exact one. It's kind of like between B and C. You know what I mean? Like more B than C, but, you know, kind of like on the verge, like a 79.5 or something. you know what I mean? But yeah, no, it was a pretty good show. I mean, I think last week's was slightly better, but it was good to see the American Wolves debut, and great main event, and good opening match too. So overall, a decent Impact again. And again, if they continue to be decent, things are going to continue to get better. And I think that Lockdown could actually be a very good pay-per-view. And if it is, then TNA is only going to keep, you know, elevating themselves further and further. So I think that the future is bright for TNA, and can be bright for TNA. I don't think it's dead yet. I think saying that the company's dead is something that's archaic. It's getting boring and old really, really quickly. Because clearly, if they were on the verge of death, I think it would be talked about a little more than it is. I mean, people do talk about, oh, it's going downhill. Yeah, well, they still are able to get crowds, at least some crowds. Even if it's not 17,000 people a week, it's still a decent amount of people coming to the shows. Even if their live events do crappy, their Impact tapings are still doing all right. Their ratings are still okay. I mean, the ratings really are pretty low in terms of wrestling, but overall their ratings aren't that terrible. And you know, they just need to find a way to attract more audiences around the United States, especially. I think that their international audience is actually better than their direct United States audience, just because more people around the world seem to care. The UK tour, they always do extremely well. People in the UK are big TNA fans, whereas in the US, I feel like a lot less people are into TNA because everybody's in for WWE. So it's territorial, just in a different way, more continental, I guess you could say. I don't know. We'll see where things go for TNA, but I of course am backing them. I want to see them do well. I want there to be two different wrestling shows to watch every week. I don't want to see TNA go down, because if they go down, then all we have is WWE. So I'd much rather have an alternative to WWE, even though